First things first. Is it too late? Should we maybe just launch all the nukes and get it over with? Professor Edgar Hertwich of NTNU is among the world's top 100 researchers in environmental science and climate research, according to rankings from Stanford University. He also leads the work on resource efficiency and climate in the UN Resource Panel. According to Hertwich, there is still some time to fix the problems. Some of the problems, that is. We have passed the first deadline with only a 1.5 degrees Celsius increase. The only way we could fix that, it was with some kind of international war economy. But what we can do is limit the increase to 2 or 2.5 degrees Celsius. Which might not sound like a lot, but it could be the difference between some tough times and the apocalypse. We need to restructure the energy system. There is no way around it. Away from fossil energy sources and over to renewable and nuclear power.
So we really have to change the politics. Today there is too little investment in climate change mitigation and clean energy. The IEA in their new World Energy Outlook says that we need to about triple our expenditure or our investment in this new technology. If we don't do that, first of all, we will not manage to do the transition. And the second thing is that we will run into shortages of energy supply.
Solar energy has become impressively cheap. Offshore wind has become much cheaper too. The problem is that we struggle to store energy for extended periods. How should we fill the need for energy when the sun and wind aren't enough? We're lucky here in Norway with our hydropower and lakes, which are fantastic to store energy. Other options can be nuclear power or fossil fuels, but where we capture and store the CO2. Now, there's been quite a fuss about CO2 capture and storage. Does it actually work? Hertwich says yes. It can work well where we have large point emissions, for example at the coal power plant or a cement factory, but capture and storage have limited potential, both due to costs and the fact that the technology works best in large facilities.
The modeling quite clearly shows if we want to phase out CO2 emissions, we either have to adopt CCS or nuclear power. It is very difficult to supply energy to a world of 10 billion with just renewable energy.
But even with finding new sources of energy, we will also have to change the way we use and produce. Hertwich was lead author on a report on house building and car production.
Currently, I'm doing research on how material efficiency in the circular economy can contribute to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So we have, for example, investigated what we can do looking at homes and cars. And we have found that substantial emission reductions are possible through measures that we could undertake right now, which basically reduce the rate of new construction of homes or the number of cars that we require in our society.
The report shows that G7 countries can save 40% of emissions with other materials, smart technology, and reuse. In China and India, the savings can be 70%. Emissions from the production, use, and scrapping of cars can be reduced by 40% in the G7 countries and 35% in China and India. If we can do all of these things and manage to cut half of mankind's emissions by 2030, it will help immensely. Unfortunately, politicians speak fine words about the climate, but do not mention that they are also doing a lot to increase emissions, with the development of roads, airports, and more drilling for oil. We will all catch a glimpse of what's to come at the climate summit in Glasgow in November. The Paris Agreement stipulated that an audit meeting shall be held every 5 years. The problem with such collective agreements is that some countries can cause ruin for everyone else by doing nothing.
This time, we are at the stage that the commitments to the Paris Agreement need to be tightened. There is a problem right now that there is a lot of conflict in the world, especially amongst the new superpower, China and the United States. Which makes it difficult to coordinate international action. The commitment from both of the superpowers to climate change mitigation is only lukewarm. They are very much internal competing forces that tried to stymie a commitment in both nations. And so that really presents a serious problem. We have made significant progress in bringing technologies to maturity that are needed in order to mitigate climate change, such as solar power and wind energy and electric vehicles. And these technologies now need to be employed at a sufficiently large scale so that we can phase out the fossil technologies that we used today to produce electricity and provide transportation services. We need to have policies in place that both address the old technologies and the introduction of the new technologies.